It's who you are. It's who you are.
Good morning, everybody.
It's who you are.
We're a small group this morning.
I'm loved by you. It's who I am.
Happy Father's Day.
It's who I am.
Father's Day.
It's who I am.
Online, either live or after the fact, just watching it later. So let's quiet our hearts and minds as we come before the Lord. And then after a couple of minutes, I would invite you to stand and we'll sing our opening hymn.
Praise ye the Father for his loving kindness. Tenderly cares he for his erring children. Praise him, ye angels. Praise him in the heavens. Praise ye Savior, great is the compassion. Graciously cares he for his chosen people, young men and maidens, ye old men and children. Praise ye the Savior. Praise ye the Spirit, Comforter of Israel, sent of the Father and the Son to bless us. Praise ye the Father, Son and Holy Spirit, praise the Eternal Three.
Blessed be God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
And together we pray. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ says. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. And together we say, Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. you are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. In the collect for today. O Lord, from whom all good proceeds, grant us the inspiration of your Holy Spirit that we may always think those things that are good, and by your merciful guidance may accomplish the same, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated for the reading of God's Word.
Morning. A reading from the book of Exodus, beginning with the 19th chapter, the first verse. On the third new moon after the people of Israel had gone out from the land of Egypt, on that day they came into the wilderness of Sinai. They set out from Rephidim and came into the wilderness of Sinai, and they encamped in the wilderness. There Israel encamped before the mountain, while Moses went up to God. The Lord called to him out of the mountain, saying, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob and tell the people of Israel, you yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession among all peoples. For all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words you shall speak to the people of Israel." So Moses came and called the elders of the people and set them before all the words that the Lord had commanded him. All the people answered together and said, "All that the Lord has spoken we will do." And Moses reported the words of the people to the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm for this morning is Psalm 100. We will read it responsively by the half verse, breaking at the asterisk. O be joyful in the Lord, all you lands.
Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before his presence with a song.
Be assured that the Lord, he is God.
It is he that has made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture.
O go your way into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise.
Be thankful unto him, and speak good of his name.
For the Lord is gracious, his mercy is everlasting.
And his truth endures from generation to generation.
And together, glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. The second reading is from Paul's letter to the Romans, the fifth chapter, beginning with the fifth verse, or with the first verse. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him, we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who's been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since, therefore, we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, Much more, now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please stand for a gradual hymn. This is a new one for us. Hopefully it will be recognizable to some of you, but it's a wonderful song by Chris Tomlin and Pat Barrett. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
And Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." And he called to him his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal every disease and every affliction. The names of the 12 apostles are these: First Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew his brother, James the son of Zebedee and John his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew the tax collector, James the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, "Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and proclaim as you go, saying, 'The kingdom of heaven is at hand.' Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse lepers, cast out demons. You received without paying, give without pay. Acquire no gold or silver or copper for your belts, no bag for your journey, or two tunics or sandals or a staff, for the laborer deserves his food. And whatever town or village you enter, find out who is worthy in it and stay there until you depart. As you enter the house, greet it. And if the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. And if anyone will not receive you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet when you leave that house or town. Truly I say to you, it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah than for that town." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you.
Now, some of you are probably wondering why the Nicene Creed is in a different place now. Typically, what we do is we say it after the sermon, but in older liturgies, like the 1662 Book of Common Prayer, the Nicene Creed came before the sermon. And what it serves actually as a benchmark. So when you say the creed, you can tell whether I'm a heretic or not by what I preach. So whether it's before or after, it's probably okay. But why I've changed the location of it is actually to give a little less time downstairs for Sunday school so that they're not looking for stuff to fill the time and that sort of thing. So it makes it a little easier for our Sunday school teachers. So let us confess together our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, and not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of our sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And let us together say the children's collect, as is our practice. Almighty God, Heavenly Father, you have blessed us with the joy and care of children. Give us calm strength and patient wisdom, so to train them that they may love all that is true and pure and lovely and of good report, following the example of their Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And Father, I pray that you would bless our children, give our Sunday school teacher the wisdom to engage with them in a in a wonderful and deep meaning way. And I pray this all in the name of Jesus. Amen. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Please be seated. Well, happy Father's Day again to all you fathers out there. And welcome to everyone to the last in our series of heresies, ancient and modern. I expected a lot of applause there for a second there, but today, following the theme of our TV game show, Jeopardy, for all those of you who watch it, our topic today is health and wealth, the prosperity gospel, or name it and claim it gospel, for $500. But it's also the daily double. So if you get it right, you get to double your money. This is actually unlike any other of the other heresies we've dealt with thus far, for it's thoroughly modern in both its development and its manifestation. And it's very insidious indeed, and it's spreading like wildfire all across the globe. In some places like Africa and Latin America, the prosperity gospel is becoming the dominant form of Christianity. In Latin America, tens of millions of people have left the once dominant Roman Catholic Church in the first quarter of the 21st century alone. And in Africa, it's been described as sweeping across the continent like a gale force wind, which is irresistible. It's reported that 62% of Africans either fully or partially affirm the tenets of the prosperity gospel. Indeed, I've shared this with you before. When Sarah and I were at GAFCON in Kigali, Rwanda, African pastors resoundingly said that there are two things which are proving to be a challenge to the stability and growth of their churches. On the one hand is Islam, and the other is Pentecostalism, which for Africans is synonymous with the prosperity gospel. The largest individual church in the world is the Yoido Full Gospel Church in South Korea, which has a reported 800,000 members. It's a prosperity gospel church. So what is this phenomenon that's sweeping across the world? Is it a move of the Spirit, or is it a move of something else? Well, the prosperity gospel has tracks its origins to the late 19th century, to something called the New Thought Movement, which came out of the United States, but also had some adherence in the UK as well. At its heart, it was a dualistic secular philosophy. Does everybody remember what dualistic means? Anyone to put up their hands and venture? Dualistic means good spiritual, bad material, and physical. And in this thinking, the material world is not reality, but it's a mere thought that only exists in the mind. The New Thought Movement emphasized maximum human potential. And just like Pelagius, who we looked at last week, our inherent divine nature gave us the ability to achieve our own salvation without connecting to any sort of higher power of the universe, God. Yet it also believed that God was imminent, that he was present within his creation. And humans could tap into this power to overcome sin, disease, and poverty. We all have the potential within ourselves to live in oneness with God, in truth, peace, health, and plenty. Almost sounds like we should be sitting in a circle singing Kumbaya. You see, for New Thought devotees, sin, sickness, and poverty were essentially matters of incorrect thinking. But positive thoughts and positive speech could bring about health and wealth and any other desired benefit. It was literally mind over matter. I think we can all agree that this is alive and well in modern New Age movement, where positive thinking and confession, thinking positive things to the universe, could lead to the actualization of one's aspirations. In the very early years of the 20th century, this New Thought Movement combined with the then new movement of Pentecostalism, where speaking in tongues, is central. And these two combined with the aspirations of the American dream. And they gel together in the thinking of someone called E. William Kenyon, a Baptist minister. Now, while he was quite conservative, he affirmed the evangelical doctrines of justification by faith, new birth in the Spirit, sanctification, how we're involved in the Great Commission, it was very missional, and the inerrancy of God's Word. He argued that the fall canceled all the guarantees that were given to Adam and Eve, leading to poverty, disease, and death. But through the atonement of Jesus on the cross, these lost privileges and rights were restored, opening up to the believer the same power that God used to create the universe. Through the cross, so the theology goes, we are already healthy, wealthy, and wise. We just need to unlock this reality through our speech. Prayer, therefore, became a binding legal act. We need to demand healing from God because we are already legally entitled to it. This became very popular in many, but not all, Pentecostal and fringe charismatic faith healing denominations. Indeed, it's what's driving. You remember a few sermons ago, I mentioned how there were 32,000 denominations now, and by 2030 or 50 or 2050, there's going to be 64,000 denominations. A lot of these denominational differences are being driven by the prosperity gospel. Now, I have to say, I'm not throwing all Pentecostals under the bus here, because not all believe the prosperity gospel, but it is very common in those in that sort of belief community. Then, building on the groundwork of Kenyon after World War II in the 1940s and 50s, the Word of Faith or Positive Confession movement began. This was phase two, under the influence of someone named Kenneth Hagin. He is considered to be by many to be the founding father of the modern prosperity gospel movement. Through the application of biblical parables of sowing and reaping, he developed something called the law of faith. When we give, especially to an anointed man of God, or for the furtherance of the ministry of the church, God is obliged to give back, perhaps 7 or even 100-fold. It's a cause and effect relationship between the believer and God. So in this thinking, faith is a spiritual law, and healing is a barometer of your faith, demonstrating its power. If we're in need of healing, we simply need to believe that the healing has already taken place. On the flip side, though, if someone is not healed, it's either because of lack of faith or that they are still under God's judgment due to unconfessed sin, or it's due to demonic influence. In this, there's need of deliverance. And all you need to do is put a little more money in the collection plate. And then say you secure your healing. And if that doesn't work, all you need to do is purchase this anointed handkerchief, fictitious obviously, for $100 to achieve the victory and the breakthrough in the Holy Spirit that is yours by right. Similarly, wealth is also a faith contract. If the believer fulfills their part of the contract, God will fulfill his. The more you sow, the more you reap. And if you aren't seeing the financial blessings, you need to simply give more to the church or to the pastor. If you think about it and you work this through to its logical conclusion, you can see how ostentation and flamboyant displays of wealth by celebrity pastors with fleets of expensive vehicles, private jets, expensive clothes and watches, and palatial mansions all over the world make sense. They are the embodiment of their theology. I feel guilty just driving to church in a Tesla. But this is the world of the televangelist, Oral Roberts, M.J. Devine, my favorite one, Creflo Dollar, Joel Osteen, Benny Hinn, Jim and Tammy Faye Baker, Paula White Kane, Kenneth Copeland, T.D. Jakes, Joyce Meyer, and others. And this is from Joel Osteen. It's God's will for you to live in prosperity instead of poverty. You must boldly declare words of faith and victory over yourself. You can see how this makes sense. Matthew 7:7 says this, "Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds. And to the one who knocks it will be opened. Or which one of you, if a son asks him for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a serpent? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him?" So what are we to think of this theology? Is it God's will for us to be healthy and wealthy? Well, listen to this from Isaiah 65. "For behold, I create new heavens and a new earth, and the former shall not be remembered or come to mind. But be glad and rejoice forever in what I create. For behold, I create Jerusalem as a rejoicing and her people a joy. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and joy in my people. The voice of weeping shall be no longer be heard, nor the voice of crying. No more shall an infant from there live but a few days, nor an old man who has fulfilled his days. For the child shall die 100 years old, but the sinner being 100 years old shall be accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For as the days of a tree, so shall be the days of my people. And my elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands, for they shall not labor in vain, nor bring forth children for trouble. For they shall be the descendants of the blessed of the Lord and their offspring with them." From this, it's apparent that God does ultimately want us to be healthy and wealthy, to thrive, to experience peace, shalom, that can only come from life with him. I think all of us will agree with this, that when we follow Jesus, the trajectory of our lives becomes better. Relationships are restored. We begin to make God-centered choices. God-centered choices as we're enabled by the Holy Spirit instead of sinful ones, as God's kingdom becomes realized in and through us. But friends, we live in the reality of the now and not yet of the kingdom of God. It's been inaugurated, but it hasn't been fulfilled. On June 6th, we remember the 79th anniversary of the D-Day landings. Some might argue that this was the day that the Nazis were ultimately defeated. But D-Day is not VE Day. We are living in those in-between times. For us, if we put it in the context of the Second World War, it's perpetually until Jesus returns, October 1944. The victory's won, but the battle still rages. And when our kingdom reality intersects with a still fallen world and society, as we participate in God's plan of redemption, the immediate outcome in the here and now may not be what we expect or want. But the final outcome will always, in God's time and plan, make sense. The question then is a matter of when. Many of you probably participated in the healing service for Bishop Charlie at St. George's Burlington. For those of you who don't know Bishop Charlie, he's a wonderful, faithful, and loving man of God who has recently retired and has recently been diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. People, I'm sure, from all over Canada and indeed the world, because he had such a huge network of people who he knew, reached out their hands that he would be healed from his disease and restored to health. But we have a faithful understanding that this might not be in the here and now. We all know God is faithful to his promises, and that Bishop Charlie, indeed all of us, will be healed ultimately in the resurrection, when our mortal bodies are transformed, just as Jesus' was. This will be our VE day, when the victory is finally won. Now some of you may be saying, well, this is just fatalism. It's not fatalism. It's faith and trust that our Heavenly Father, our good, good Father, hears us in prayer. And if it is in accordance with his will, he will grant our requests. Ultimately, in this present age, healing is due to God's will, to bring about his purposes. And friends, there is no safer place than being in the center of the will of God. So what about wealth? Well, Scripture actually has a very complicated relationship with wealth. It's replete, especially in the Old Testament, of references to wealth as being a blessing from God. In Genesis 26, 12 and following, it says, "And Isaac sowed in that land and reaped in the same year a hundredfold, and the Lord blessed him. And the man became rich and gained more and more until he became very, very wealthy." Deuteronomy 28, verses 1 to 14, details the financial blessings and prosperity that come to God's people through obedience to his commandments. And the poor in Proverbs are chastised for being poor, for not being diligent and being foolish. Yet there's also the book of Job, who, while being wealthy, loses everything, and yet in the end has his fortunes restored because it is God's will. Indeed, wealth is also seen through much of the New Testament as a temptation. How the rich use their wealth and power to oppress the poor when they trust in it and not in God. This ultimately leads to a concept in Scripture called the reversal of fortunes, where the poor are exalted and the rich are laid low, for they have already received their reward. In the final analysis, it's not the absence or presence of wealth that is the core issue. It's our attitude of our hearts, that's important. As it says in Proverbs 30, verses 8 and 9, and this is one of my favorite passages in all of Scripture, "Remove far from me falsehood and lying. Give me neither poverty nor riches. Feed me with the food that is needful for me, lest I be full and deny you and say, 'Who is the Lord?' Or lest I be poor and steal and profane the name of my God." Friends, our model of the abundant life is not Joel Osteen with his perfect hair, shiny teeth, expensive Italian suit, and fancy car, speaking to 45,000 people in a stadium. It's our Savior Jesus, who lived as an itinerant preacher, commanding his disciples to go out and preach the word without so much as a spare set of clothes. He, in obedience to the will of the Father, died a cruel death on the cross, but was raised from the dead and ascended into heaven with his glorified body, where he is seated in glory, reigning over heaven and earth. This is health and wealth. As it says in our epistle today, we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. My brothers and sisters, the sin of the prosperity gospel is that it is not God-centered. It is human-centered. It is no longer seeking the Lord's will when you pray. It's being like a spoiled child, demanding my will, our will, of God. It treats God like a supernatural vending machine or a genie in a bottle, dispensing the blessings of the abundant life. But these blessings will only ultimately be manifest in the end. And it's not necessarily because I deserve it. It's because of what Jesus did on the cross. At the beginning of this series, I posed a question to you. Do some of these heresies that we talked about cease to be Christianity at all? They sound Christian, but are they actually Christian? Well, the health and wealth gospel fundamentally is actually a very pagan understanding of God. It's all about controlling the divine to achieve certain ends. I can do certain things, say magical incantations in the name of Jesus, so that God will give me certain things. If you break it down, it's actually a fertility cult. It's Baal worship, where you sacrifice something, even your own children, to get something back in return. It's no wonder that some churches boast tens of thousands of adherents. They preach a gospel that itching ears want to hear. Friends, this is not the gospel. The gospel is, as our epistle says today, that God shows his love for us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more, now that we are reconciled, shall be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we now have received reconciliation. We come to God as sinners, saved by grace, through the blood of Jesus, serving him in thankfulness for his love, his justice, and his mercy. So as we come to the end of this sermon series, I hope you have learned a lot. I hope you have seen how some of the heresies, although ancient, most of them are actually still with us, albeit in slightly different forms. I hope you have seen the importance of an orthodox, that's with a small o, understanding of the faith and how it leads to life. I hope you have seen a common trend in these heresies, that they are departures from the true faith designed to serve us and not to serve God. Though rooted in Scripture, they entertain worldly philosophies that distort and twist the Word of God. And friends, if there's anything that I have said that resonates with you, that you thought was Christian, that you believed, but is not, repent of it, ask God for his forgiveness, and receive his forgiveness in thanks. For Scripture says he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Friends, this is ultimately our prize, our pearl of great price, forgiveness and restoration with God Almighty. And this is something you can't buy. You can't demand it. It's a gift. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. So perhaps the best way to end this series off is how I started it, with the words of Paul to Timothy. I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is the judge, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing in his kingdom, preach the word, be ready in season and out of season, reprove, rebuke, and exhort, with complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. As for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. I pray this for all of us in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Please remain seated and adopt an attitude of prayer as we're led in the prayers of the people.
Let us pray for the church, the world, and for all people according to their need. Almighty and ever-living God, we are taught by your holy word to offer prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all people. We humbly ask you mercifully to receive our prayers. Inspire the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all who confess your holy name may agree in the truth of your holy word and live in unity and godly love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we pray asking that you will lead the nations of the world in the way of righteousness, and so guide and direct their leaders and ours, especially King Charles, Justin, our Prime Minister, Doug, our Premier, that your people may enjoy the blessings of freedom and peace. Grant that our leaders may impartially administer justice, uphold integrity and truth, restrain from wickedness and vice, and protect true religion and virtue. Lord, in your mercy, give grace, Heavenly Father, to all bishops, priests, and deacons. We lift to you your servants, Archbishop Foley Beach and Bishop Dan Gifford. We pray for our priest and Pastor Devin and honorary assistant, Reverend Leba. In the Anglican Church of North America cycle of prayer, we pray for the upcoming Provincial Council and College of Bishops meeting. In the Anglican Network in Canada cycle of prayer, we pray for ANiC congregations in Ontario, St. Hilda's in Oakville, St. Peter by the Park in Hamilton, St. George's in Burlington, Good Shepherd in St. Catharines, St. Jude in Guelph, the St. Barnabas Anglican Mission in Wilsonville, and All Saints in the GTA in Mississauga. In the Clericus cycle of prayer this morning, Father, we pray for our parish, Eternal Hope. We pray for a Grace Anglican Church in Clayton and the Reverend Trudy Hardy. And we pray for Living Waters Anglican Fellowship in Kingston, the Reverend Chris During. In the parish cycle of prayer this morning, Father, we lift up to you Richard and Dorothea and Ruth and the Reverend Willard Kamandani and Holy Cross Anglican Church in Chikwawa, Malawi. Heavenly Father, we pray for the church established and new congregations, asking to all your people that you, Father, will give your heavenly grace that with reverent and obedient hearts we may hear and receive your holy word and serve you in holiness and righteousness all the days of our lives. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, prosper, we pray, all those who proclaim the gospel of your kingdom throughout the world. And we pray especially for all missionaries, asking that you strengthen them to fulfill your great commission, making disciples of all nations, baptizing them and teaching them to obey all that you have commanded. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we ask you in your goodness to comfort and sustain all who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. Almighty God, we pray for people around the world who are victims of internal or international conflict, or natural disasters that are threatening health, safety, or well-being. We lift up to you people who are facing wildfires in this country. We pray for the people of Ethiopia and Kenya, Somalia, Sudan, Afghanistan, Yemen, Pakistan, and the Ukraine. We ask, Heavenly Father, that you make war cease to the ends of the earth and bring about an end to drought, flood, wildfires, and famine. Speed the restoration of community life. Heavenly Father, we pray for persecuted Christians, particularly those who are at daily risk of being raided by authorities. Give them the courage to endure. And we thank you, Father, for their boldness and for their faithfulness to you. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the great physician. You can heal all manner of sickness and illness through the power of your Holy Spirit. We ask that you send healing and wholeness to all who we lift to you now, either on our lips or in our hearts. We pray for Caitlin and Trudy, Caroline, Rebecca, Anne, Mike, Ivan, and Dean, for Richard and Dorothea, and Bishop Charlie, and others we lift to you now. Heavenly Father, look with gracious favor upon these your servants. Give wisdom and discretion to those who minister to them in their sickness. Bless all the means used for their recovery. Stretch forth your hand and according to your will, restore them to health and strength, that they may live to praise you for your goodness and your grace, to the glory of your holy name. Lord, in your mercy, we remember before you all your servants who have departed this life in your faith and fear. We pray that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we ask you now to give us grace to follow their good examples, that we may share with them in your heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, grant these our prayers for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
All who truly and earnestly repent you of your sins and seek to live in love and charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead the new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and make your humble confession to Almighty God. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker and judge of us all, we acknowledge and lament our many sins and offenses, which we have committed by thought, word, and deed against your divine majesty, provoking most justly your righteous anger against us. We are deeply sorry for these our transgressions. The burden of them is more than we can bear. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may evermore serve and please you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. The saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. If anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit.
Please greet one another in the peace of Christ. Peace, Aaron. Peace, Ken. For everybody who I missed, because I had to get back up here, peace. So it's now our offertory. Ken, could you just go to the next slide? I just wanted to remind everybody that there's three kind of main ways if you wanted to offer to the financial needs of the church. One of them is through e-transfer, and that's the email up there. The other one is through Church Connect, and that's the, if you pick up a bulletin, there's a QR code there, you can scan that, and that way I actually fits in with all of our church tracking software for donations and receipts and all that sort of stuff, or then you can also give in person. And if you give online, there's a container full of crosses at the back there. If you give online and you want to use a tangible way of noting your donation, just put a cross into the offering plate, and that way it will be way we can say a blessing over it and that sort of thing. So, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Please remain standing for our offertory hymn, Lord, whose love through humble service.
Lord, whose love through humble service bore the weight of human need, who upon the cross forsaken offered mercy's perfect deed. We, your servants, bring the worship, not a voice alone but heart, consecrating to your purpose every gift that you impart. Still your children wander homeless, still the hungry cry for bread, still the captives long for freedom, still in grief we mourn our dead. As, O Lord, your deep compassion healed the sick and freed the soul, use the love your Spirit kindles still to save and make us whole. As we worship, grant us vision till your love's revealing light in its height and depth and greatness dawns upon our quickened sight, making known the needs and burdens your compassion bids us bear, stirring us to tireless striving your abundant life to share. Called by worship to your service, forth in your dear name we go. To the child, the youth, the aged, love and living deeds to show. Hope and health, goodwill and comfort, counsel, aid and peace we give, that your servants, Lord, in freedom may your mercy know and live.
Creatures here below, praise
Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. All things come from you, O Lord.
And of your own have we given.
Our service for those who are following in the prayer book continues on page 115. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Remain standing. All praise and glory is yours, O God, our Heavenly Father, for in your tender mercy you gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption. He made there, by his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world. And he instituted, and in his holy gospel commanded us to continue, a perpetual memory of his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. So now, O merciful Father, in your great goodness, we ask you to bless and sanctify with your word and Holy Spirit these gifts of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. For on the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of your dearly beloved Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, we, your humble servants, celebrate and make here before your divine majesty with these holy gifts the memorial your Son commanded us to make. Remembering his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and his promise to come again. And we earnestly desire your fatherly goodness mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, asking you to grant that by the merits and death of your Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and your whole church may obtain forgiveness of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present to you ourselves, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice. We humbly pray that all who partake of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with your grace and heavenly benediction, and be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. And although we are unworthy because of our many sins to offer you any sacrifice, yet we ask you to accept this duty and service we owe, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. By him and with him and in him in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
I invite you to please adopt an attitude of prayer. And together let us pray the prayer of humble access. We do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose character is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Once again, if you're a baptized Christian, in the name of the Father and the Son of the Holy Spirit, you're welcome to the Lord's table. If you'd like to come forward and just receive a blessing, just come forward with your arms crossed across your chest, and I'll say a blessing over you. Can you put it on the slide for spiritual communion? Oh, back one more. For those of you who are joining us online, this is a prayer. This is from the Book of Common Prayer, but it says, Dear Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the Holy Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to possess you within my soul. And since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, I beseech you to come spiritually into my heart. I unite myself to you, together with all your faithful people gathered around every altar of your church, and I embrace you with all the affections of my soul. So that's for those of you who are unable to join us in person, and hopefully that is those words there are a blessing to you. Caroline, the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, given for you, preserve your body and soul to everlasting life. Alana, the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, given for you, preserve your body and soul to everlasting life. Barb, the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, given for you, preserve your body and soul to everlasting life. Emmett, the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, given for you. Steph, the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, given for you, preserve your body and soul to everlasting life. Grace, the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, given for you. Matt, the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, given for you, preserve your body and soul to everlasting life. Body of our Lord Jesus Christ, given for you, preserve your body and soul to everlasting life. Jerry, the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, given for you, preserve your body and soul to everlasting life. Our service continues on page 121. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us in these holy mysteries with the spiritual food, the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us through this sacrament of your favor and goodness towards us, that we are true members of the mystical body of your Son, the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of your everlasting kingdom. And we humbly ask you, Heavenly Father, to assist us with your grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship and do all the good works that you have prepared for us to walk in. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor, glory, now and forever. Amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you this day and always. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated for some announcements. Try and make it. The Lambton County Interval House is having a bake sale in conjunction with the Bridge Street Grand Opening, which is this Saturday coming up between 10 and 3. So if you would like to donate some baked goods to them, you need to have it to them by June the 23rd, the night before or the day before, and you can drop off your donations at 100 Moore Street. June 24th is going to be a busy day. I've pushed our fellowship breakfast from this Saturday to next Saturday just because of being Father's Day weekend and everything like that. But then I realized that it's actually that Bridge Street Grand Opening. So we are actually, since I made up the slide, I've made up a new moniker. It's called Bibles on Bridge Street. So at Alana's store, she's so graciously donated a small section of sidewalk that we can use. We're setting up a table, and Dave Barker, who is, I think he's playing golf today, but anyway, he's in a tournament or something. But anyway, he is a member of the Gideons, so he is getting us Bibles in English, Ukrainian, Arabic, French, all sorts of different languages. So between 10 and 3, we are setting up a little table in front of Alana's store on Bridge Street. Yeah?
Yeah, he's got Bibles 100 Bridge Street.
100? It's 117, though, isn't
yeah.
it?
It's, no, one s- it's 100 in here.
Oh, okay. My mistake.
Okay.
Anyway, it's 117. I knew it was 117. I don't know why I said 100. Anyway, it's 117. Just look for us. I'll be there. But anyway, if you'd like to participate, I thought if we could maybe sort of do it in shifts, I thought that might be a good way of doing it so that some of us aren't there for 4-5 hours, although that's totally fine. But anyway, if you'd like to volunteer, I actually have set up a registration page on our Church Connect group page. If anybody doesn't know about that, the QR code on the front of the bulletin will take you to our Church Connect page. And there's events there. There's the fellowship breakfast is there, so if you want to sign up for that so I know who's coming. But if you'd like to sign up for the Bibles on Bridge Street, that would be great, and then we can kind of maybe set up a schedule so we can be part of that. I'll probably be there most of the day, I would think. And then, if that's not good enough, we're going to do the same thing on Canada Day. So anyway, so you can sign up for one or both of those situations. There's no coffee hour today because it's Father's Day, and I'm sure many of us have events that we have to get to. And you've probably heard in our prayers of the people and in our bulletins and stuff that we support a church in Chikwawa, Malawi. It's a pastor who I met at GAFCON. And so what we at the board level decided to do was our quarterly tithe, we kind of gave an advance of that, and we bought some goats for their goat project in Malawi. So what they're doing there is they're setting up a goat herd, and then they're using that. This is very common in Africa to use goats as your bank account because they're pretty disease hardy and they reproduce fairly readily. So what they're doing is they're using that actually to fund the church because it's an area of quite high unemployment, that area. And they're also using that as a project to provide employment for people who will take care of the goat herds and stuff like that. Anyway, as seed money, we gave them an advance on our quarterly tithe for this second quarter of the year. And they managed to, they have bought 5 goats thus far. I was in communication with Pastor Willard yesterday, or the day before maybe. Anyway, and they're going to purchase another 5 this next week. So pictures will be coming soon of the goats that we purchased for them. Are there any birthdays or anniversaries or important events out in the congregation that we need to know? No. Well, please stand for our closing hymn, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling.
Excelling, joy of heaven to earth come down, fix in us thy humble dwelling, all thy faithful mercies crown. Jesus, thou art all compassion, pure unbounded love thou art. Visit us with thy salvation, enter every trembling heart. Breathe, O breathe, thy loving spirit into every troubled breast. Let us all in thee inherit. Let us find the promised rest. Take away our bent to sinning, Alpha and Omega be. End of faith as its beginning, set our hearts at liberty. Come, Almighty, to deliver, let us all thy grace receive. Suddenly return and never, never more thy temples leave. Thee we would be always blessing, serve thee as thy host above. Pray and praise thee without ceasing, glory in thy perfect love.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.